a challenging section of Scripture, but it's a helpful for one for us to be mindful of as we think about the ways that God can minister to us, even in the case, and maybe especially so in the case of suffering with trials and persecutions and calamities and weaknesses and insults and difficulties. It's helpful for us to begin with that section from 2 Corinthians 12 because it shows us that when these things happen, while from the outside oftentimes they may even look chaotic, we may even wonder why these things are happening to us or what God will do through these things. It's helpful for us to see that in Paul's instance anyways, and I believe from the text we'll look at in Colossians, that these things were allowed and maybe even caused by God for specific purposes. And if it's for no other purpose than for us to recognize that it is God's strength upon which we ultimately rely for our everything, then I would argue it will be worth it. Paul has just gone on in 2 Corinthians 12 to talk about this this amazing vision that he, in third-person form, tells his audience that he received. 2 Corinthians 12 talks about if Paul should go on boasting. And before, in chapter 11, he's talking about boasting, about being a fool, as the world would consider it. So if he must go on boasting, though there's nothing to be gained by it, I will go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. Paul says, I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. This ancient idea of the first heaven being the abode of the birds, and then the second heaven being the idea of the abode of the stars and the planets, this third heaven giving light to this reality of where God dwells, that this person 14 years ago was given this vision as he was caught up to the third heaven, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man was caught up into paradise. Definitely a good description for God's presence, I would argue, huh? He's caught up into paradise, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And he heard things that cannot be told, which man may not utter. That's an important rule, I think, for those who have heavenly visitations, or tell you they do. One person who was given this visitation, likely Paul here, was told not to tell of these things. So Paul's given this amazing vision. He's been given a revelation of God. I would argue this is Paul, but then he was given a revelation of God that would further empower him in his ministry. On behalf of this man, I will boast, Paul says in verse 5, but on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. Though if I should wish to boast, I would not be a fool, for I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it so that no one may think more of me than he sees in me or hears from me, which namely would be Christ. And so Paul desired to be made known everywhere he went, to make much of Christ. So if people see Paul, he would hope that they are seeing Christ. And if Paul is talking, it's not Paul he wants them to hear, it's Christ that he wants them to hear. He said, if I'm boasting, I want to be boasting of the true things, of the things that people see and hear me say, which is Christ. So to keep me, verse 7, to keep me from becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a hint back likely to that heavenly vision he was given. To keep me from boasting or becoming conceited because of the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from becoming conceited. Satan is not running around unleashed in the world today, even though it appears to be. Satan is still God's Satan. God is still omnipotent and powerful over all, and there is not anything that is outside of his control. And he can actually use a negative influence in Paul's life to keep him humble, to keep him focused on and directly reliant upon Jesus Christ. I'm hearing a lot of feedback, sorry. And I think maybe this morning we'll come to a conclusion of exactly what this thorn in the flesh is, which is, I don't know. Was it a pain that he had? I don't know. Was it a temptation that he was battling and had to fight with? I don't know. But we know that it was something that was could be pointed back to being evil, something that was challenging to him to battle and to fight, and God allowed it to happen, that he allowed this messenger of Satan to keep this thorn in the flesh. And Paul says, three times, I pleaded with the Lord that it should leave me, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. I think that that is so important for us when we think about suffering, because when God says no to the alleviation of suffering, that's actually an answer in the affirmative to say, rely on me. I can be your all in all through the suffering. In fact, my power is made perfect in your weakness. And it's an easier thing to study academically or intellectually or to write notes on or to underline in your Bible and to say, okay, when I'm in that circumstance and I ask God to alleviate the suffering and it doesn't happen, I will remember this and I'll nail it the first time. It's not going to be the case, very likely. We're going to have to be reminded of this, or we're going to have to walk, or we're going to have to walk with brothers and sisters who have walked through challenging times to be reminded of this. And they may be Christ for you, that the Holy Spirit is in them ministering to you to comfort you through your trials and through your sufferings. And Paul had to learn that. I don't think Paul could have been used mightily of God if he was trying to push forth the Paul agenda or to make a big name for Paul. He could care less about Paul. He wants people to know Jesus, even in his sufferings. God said to him when he pleads for this thorn in the flesh, this messenger from Satan to harass him, for it should leave, he says, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Now Paul knows true boasting. I will boast, therefore I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then I am content. Make this your life verse. For the sake of Christ, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. Paul doesn't say there that I'm seeking these things. He's saying, when they come, when I'm in the ministry of Jesus Christ, when I'm traveling and I'm trying to tell people about Jesus Christ, when I go to the synagogues and they want to ridicule me or chase me and want me dead, I'm just giving them Christ. If, when I go to the marketplace, to the Areopagus, and I'm Mars Hill, I give the sermon, I preach Christ and people are saved. Hey, I didn't save them, it's Christ that saved them. Whatever goes on in my ministry, as long as I am seeking Christ and I want to make much of him and I'm reliant upon his power, whether persecutions come or successes come, it's all Christ. How many of us are content with weakness? And insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. If contentedness is lashing out, I'm good at it. You're going to insult me? Well, I'm throwing one back at you. I'm not content with that. I want to lash out. I want to defend myself or whatever the case may be. Paul's saying he's content. Come what may. Persecutions, trials, struggles, tribulations, to live as Christ, to die as gain. That's Paul's motto. The sufferings have a purpose. Ministry-born sufferings have a purpose in your life, and they're to cause you and to call you to be more reliant upon God for that power. And we have that true for us today through the power of the Holy Spirit. And I wanted us to read that section because I think it gives us the mind of Paul as he, in shorter form, handles a similar topic here in Colossians. And so we're going to hear from another Paul, and we're going to hear from Colossians 1, verses 24 through 28 on our screens.
Colossians 1, 24 through 28. I rejoice in my suffering for your sake, and in my flesh I do share on behalf of his body, which is a church, in filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions. Of this church I was made a minister according to the stewardship from God, bestowed upon me for your benefit, so that I might fully carry out the preaching of the word of God, that is, the mystery which has been hidden from the past ages and generations, has now been manifested to his saints, whom God will make known of his riches of the glory of his mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. We proclaim him, admonishing every man and teaching every man with all wisdom, so that we may be present, every man complete in Christ.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. Father, we thank you that your word does not sidestep suffering. Father, that your word does not sidestep weakness, but Father, points us to an utter reliance upon Jesus for our everything. Father, may we learn from Paul's writing and his encouragement to the church in Colossae that a dependence upon you is absolutely necessary for anything that can be done for the cause of Christ. Lord, may we be content with whatever comes our way for being focused on, based upon, and have our rich, firm, unchanging foundation in Jesus Christ. It's in his powerful name we pray. Amen. So if we think about where Paul has placed this particular teaching in the life of the church of the Colossians in his letter to them, he's just finished up that beautiful Christ hymn. And he's also talked in verses 21 through 23 that we looked at last week about reconciliation, that we have our place in the body of Christ because God has reconciled us. The one offended has sought out reconciliation, has put forth his only Son, Jesus Christ, as the sacrifice that we so desperately needed. Now he's moving on to remind them that they will suffer just as Paul has suffered. That when you stand in a culture and in a society as Colossians did, as those that were following Christ did in that world, that they will suffer. When you stand opposite of a world that is hedonistic, that is seeking to satisfy every earthly and fleshly pleasure that they have in many realms, whether that was supposed religiosity or philosophical in nature or even just fleshly in nature, that when you stand opposed to that, you will suffer. It doesn't say seek that suffering, but as you live a life obedient to Christ, you will look different. And you will suffer. And Paul begins this teaching with the, it seems, contradictory statement that he rejoices in his sufferings. Like, when's the last time you suffered? And you're like, yes! Woohoo! Come on over, bring the confetti and balloons of suffering. No, but Paul recognizes the necessity of the suffering because you do stand opposite of the world. You do look different from the world around you. And it's not a happy rejoicing in terms of I'm so thrilled to be suffering, but it's a reminder and a reality that when we suffer, that this was allowed by God or maybe even caused by him in the case of that thorn in the flesh and the minister of Satan sent to Paul to harass him. That he can rejoice because it's almost confirming the reality that he is a minister of the gospel. The gospel looks different to the world. So he's rejoicing. I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I am filling up what is lacking in Christ's afflictions for the sake of his body that is the church. I would argue, probably on pretty safe grounds, that this verse probably has more ink spilled over it in the writings and explanation of it than any other verse in this letter. What could possibly be lacking in Christ's afflictions? Because on face value, that makes us think that there's something missing. There was a negligent aspect of Christ's substitutionary atonement for you that was missing that is now necessary in order for you to be saved. That's the most common misunderstanding. There are many others, but that's the one that's most common, that there was something missing in Christ's passion from Good Friday on through his resurrection that is now necessary for you to actually be saved. So Christ did almost all of it, but something's needed. And for Paul, it was suffering for others. So now Paul can be saved. And I want to tell you right now, very firmly and very clearly, that that is not the right understanding. There is zero, nothing missing from the suffering of Christ for you, for your atonement. And I can make that case on the basis of the language that's actually used here, because Paul, for the word affliction, at least in my translation, it says, I'm filling up for you. I'm filling up what is lacking in Christ's affliction for the sake of his body. That word afflictions is never once used by Paul for his atonement in referring to Christ's atoning sacrifice. This can be likely referring to what Christ experienced throughout his earthly ministry when people were like, he's crazy, he's mad, you know, get his family to call him home, he's nuts. Or when they accused him of blasphemy for saying, my goodness, he's making himself on par with God. He's making himself equal with God. Let's kill him. It was very likely referring to those afflictions, and it also points us to the reality that God knows everything and knows that people will continue to suffer for the gospel of Jesus Christ until Jesus returns. So if you leave here today, I want you to understand that this does not mean that there was anything missing in Jesus' perfect and complete work on the cross. But it also means that we will suffer. And the great news about the fact that God knows we will suffer is that should give you comfort in your suffering. I'll let it do that. But it also gives you purpose in your suffering. If God is aware that Paul would have some suffering, and actually all the suffering he would ever experience in his ministry for Jesus Christ, then couldn't Paul move forward in suffering and not look at suffering as a sign of defeat? Because if I was in prison for the gospel of Jesus Christ, and my understanding was I have to be free for the gospel to go forth, because, you know, God needs me. So if I was Paul and I had this idea that my suffering was actually a sign of defeat or a slowdown or a hindrance to the gospel, I couldn't rejoice in prison. I would be like, y'all got to bring me out of here. Let's do some midnight stuff where we, you know, Dukes of Hazzard, the bars off, the jail, and we get free. But if you can have the understanding that suffering is part of your walk with Christ, in particular, especially for the ministry of the gospel of Jesus Christ, then when you suffer, when you are in prison, when you are beaten, when you are killed and martyred for the faith, that is not a hindrance to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And you can actually rejoice, like, hey, God called this for me, but I'm going to suffer in this moment, in this time. That changes exactly how you vision or discern suffering in your life for the sake of the gospel. A wayward child is ticked off and mad because you're a Christian and you talk to them about the gospel. It's not for nothing. Love them and continue to example Christ to them. Share the love of Christ with them. Be a model of Christ and suffer well in the face of slander and insults and painful separation. Suffer well and continue to model Christ. You're in the workforce and you have to be honest because you're a follower of Christ and Jesus is true and the way, the truth, and the life. And you suffer for modeling Christ in the workforce. Rejoice. You get an opportunity to demonstrate that Jesus makes a difference in your life. And you're a changed person. And you no longer want to walk in darkness, but you're trying to walk in light, even in the workforce. Or in your neighborhood. You have an opportunity to stand for Christ, to maybe even suffer for him, as you witness the gospel to him. I can give you one piece of advice if you want to avoid suffering and you want everything to be comfortable. Zip your lips and don't tell anyone about Jesus. If you want a comfortable life, if you don't ever want to suffer, if you don't want to have any afflictions, insults, hardships, calamities, just don't tell anyone you're Christ's. That he owns you. That he's your master. He loves you. Just keep your mouth shut. Everything will go well for you. You'll have the happiest neighborhood in the world, you think. You'll have the happiest Thanksgiving table in the world, you think. Or you have the privilege to suffer for him by speaking the truth in love, by changing the way you operate at work, the way you demonstrate your faith in your neighborhood, or a million other ways the life of Christ manifests itself in your life. And rejoice when suffering happens. In particular, that suffering that makes you go, I just can't see a way through it. I don't know how things are going to get better. When I am weak, it gives me strength. then I am strong. Paul's reminding this church that lives in a culture that says there's millions of roads to God, that you can satisfy worship to God in a million pagan and disgusting ways, that you can just go on believing anything you want, and that you can live any way you want, and that you can do anything you want with your body and all these things. Paul's reminded that as you are changed and owned by Christ, you will suffer, and as you suffer, God is aware of it. Find comfort in that. That he can ordain even your suffering and walk with you through it. They say that you don't learn a whole lot of life lessons in easy times, right? Like sometimes we get spiritually flabby in easy times. And it's the hard times that come that call us to obedience and to rely on him all the more. And Paul's saying, man, Colossae, when that happened to me, I rejoiced because I suffered for the gospel in order to bring this message to this arena, to this area, and to ultimately have that gospel message reach this church in Colossae. He's saying, I rejoice because I'm filling up what is lacking in Christ's affliction for the sake of his body, that is the church. And this idea comes forth, we can see it again in Revelation as well. In Revelation chapter 6, this is a talking about the seals and this beautiful vision that the Apostle John was given. And in chapter 6 of Revelation, beginning in verse 9, there's a fifth seal that's being opened. And there's something instructive for us, I think, for our text this morning. The Lamb, which is Jesus Christ, is opening up the seals. He's the only one worthy to be able to open up the seals. In verse 9, when he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the witness they had borne. I want to stop here for just a moment because John, I wonder if he saw his brother James who was beheaded for the faith. I wonder if John saw Stephen, the soul of Stephen underneath there. Like, this isn't just some indiscriminate group of people. These are followers of Christ who've lost their life for the sake of the gospel. And John's given this vision that he sees the souls of those who had been slain for the word of God and for the witness they had borne. Verse 10, and they cried out with a loud voice, O sovereign Lord, holy and true, how long before you will judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth? That's a good question, I'm sure. They know what other people are experiencing, the suffering that's going on. They want it to end, right? Man, yeah. Verse 11. Then they were each given a white robe and told to rest a little longer until the number of their fellow servants and their brothers should be complete, who were to be killed as they themselves had been. The Lord of the universe knows everything. Today, yesterday, tomorrow, all of it. The Lord can look at the souls who are given robes and told to rest a little while longer. I know how many are coming in the same way you suffered. Rest. The gospel's going forth. People are going to suffer. Rest. And there's an awareness in the throne room of heaven of the full number of those, the numbers of those that, until it's complete, that will suffer. Those that are going to lay down their lives for the cost of the gospel, for following Jesus Christ. It's happening still today. And I can look at that and go, chaos, mess, disorder. Or I can look at that and go, the gospel's going forth. It's the price. And God knows precisely how much suffering will happen before Jesus returns. And Paul could look at his suffering and go, it's another drop closer to eternity, to the glory of God coming in fullness. You could rejoice. And he's reminding this church this very same thing. I rejoice in my sufferings, verse 24 of Colossians 1. I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh I am filling up what is lacking in Christ's affliction, Christ's earthly suffering, not his atonement, for the sake of his body. He's even giving the emphasis back to Jesus, not himself, that is the church, verse 25, of which I became a minister according to the stewardship from God that was given to me for you to make the word of God fully known. Paul was commissioned to the gospel not to make a big deal of himself. Coming soon to an arena near you, the Apostle Paul and his preaching tour. Come and hear him and be awed and amazed at his rhetoric and amazing persuasive skills. I want to tell you about Jesus. Hey, you see that altar, the unknown God? I know him. His name's Jesus. Let me tell you about him. He's defeated death. He's resurrected. Oh, boo, hiss. We don't want to hear that. Okay, I'm still going to talk about it. We're going to chase you out of this town. Fine, chase me. I got more places to go. In fact, the Holy Spirit will lead me and hinder me. I really want to go here, Lord. Closing that door. You're going over here. Why? Suffer more. Because the gospel's going forth. Paul had learned painfully well that when he is weak, the power of Christ is in him and can make him strong. He was given stewardship from God. We don't appoint ourselves as ministers of the gospel. He was given stewardship from God that was given to him, and the purpose was to make the word of God fully known, all of it, old and new, Genesis to Revelation, every jot, every tittle, every iota, all of it, make it known. Don't skip over stuff when it makes you uncomfortable. Deal with it. Walk through it and ask God for help. The word of God fully known. That's the purpose of Paul's suffering. He knows it's going to happen. He can get comfort because he knows God knows it's going to happen. God's walking him into it. And he's even letting them know that there's this mystery here. And for Paul, the mystery is always this idea of the Gentile and the Jews coming together underneath this single exclusive plan of salvation. Verse 26, the mystery hidden for ages and generations, but now revealed to his saints. To them God chose, to his saints, to them God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. How often do we think about hope? Oh, do we need it? How often do we think about the hope as riches of eternal glory? Like not a sentimental, fleeting thought or a platitude you say to boost yourself in the morning, but a reality that will actually be visible and you will experience tangibly with a physical body one day in the new heavens and new earth. You will experience the riches of the glory of God, and that is your great hope in Christ. It's real. It's tangible. You will experience it. He is comparing real realities of things you experience, things you can feel pain from, physical pain, being beaten for the faith, or being tortured to death for the faith, or psychological pain, being insulted and having family turn their back on you, or being cast out of a family, that pain. He's saying, yes, those things are real, you experience them, but how much greater is the eternal hope that we have to walk and be in God's presence in Christ forever, tangibly, experientially, not floating on a cloud with some fake pair of wings and a harp, but tangibly experiencing the glory of God that no man apart from Christ could ever see in this existence. I mean, just the trailing edge of the visible essence of God's glory, Moses had to be hidden in the cleft of the rock so that he wasn't consumed. And then you will one day be in that presence because you are in Christ. The suffering has a purpose. Paul's been given this amazing gift of being a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ to make the word of God fully known, to explain to mixed populations of Jews and Gentiles that there's one Savior and his name is Jesus Christ. It's a mystery. It was hidden for ages, but now it's been revealed, and he wants to make that known to them because God has chosen these means by which he can tell the Gentiles that there are riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. And to further remind them that this isn't about Paul, he says, him we proclaim in Christ, Christ in you. It's Christ we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom that we may present everyone mature in Christ. We're good with one of those words typically as Christians today, teaching. Like we will get drunk with knowledge. Give me more. Of the writing of books, there is no end. I've got shelves to prove it. And to be read stacks like this big from the ground. Like, why I ever buy another book? Foolish. We're okay with teaching. We like to accumulate for ourselves knowledge. And a lot of times this is a good thing, right? But Paul also says be warned. And that's where we go, I don't know about that. Don't step on my toes. You can't tell me that's sin. You can't tell me that I need to separate myself from that instead, because I got to be me. Or the vernacular of today, my truth. There shouldn't be any modifier for the word truth. There is the truth, and his name is Jesus. So we're pretty good with teaching. We can accumulate for ourselves teachings, because you know what teaching we can do? We can discern, and we can get rid of things we don't want to honor. We can get rid of things we do want to honor, and we can implement things that we want to do that, you know, because it suits our personality and our needs. But, you know, I don't want to say no to that because that makes me happy sometimes. And the Bible calls that a sin. That's misinterpreting. No. When the gospel goes forth, it goes forth with a warning to everyone. No one is excluded. It goes forth to everyone that we need to repent and trust in Jesus Christ, and that we need to leave the sinful vestiges of our lives behind, and he will give us the power to do it, that we can flee from the devil and flee to Jesus. We can resist the devil, and the devil will flee from you, and that we can find safe harbor in Jesus Christ, and that we can find power to say no to sin, because no temptation has overcome man by which God hasn't given us escape. That we accept that, you know what usually happens, why people suffer and why people are afflicted and insulted and persecuted for the cause and name of Jesus Christ, it's because they're brave enough to warn. If you don't want to warn, then you're a carnival barker. You're putting people in seats to make them feel happy and put on a show. And Paul's saying, I'm not here just to teach. I'm here to warn. I'm here to warn primarily that there is an eternity to come. He's just told us about an eternal glory in Christ, which means there is eternity apart from Christ for those that aren't in him. And that is the strongest warning we could ever utter. And to avoid that and to sidestep that and to try to dance around that or give other systems by which you can be right and maybe get out of hell someday is a flat-out lie. But you'll avoid suffering. You died in your sins. You never repented and trusted Jesus Christ. Well, don't worry. You know, if you're there for 1,000 years and if enough people pray for you and enough people give money to the church in your name or if enough people get baptized for you, you'll eventually come out. Bovine scatology. That leads people to hell into an eternity. Trust in Jesus Christ now. And then after you follow him, he calls us to walk a certain way. Those that hear my voice, follow me. We listen to what he says and we obey him. Why? Because he loves us, because he's the good shepherd. He doesn't say, don't go over there and eat of that weed because it's actually good for you. He's warning you. It may even taste sweet, but it's poison. And he calls on people in the Sermon on the Mount. I'd argue he probably had a lot of men in mind here, but more and more this day and age, it's also women. When he says, when you lust after somebody with your eyes, that's adultery of the heart. Make a covenant with your eyes, men. I'm warning you. You're either going to sacrifice blessings in heaven or you're proving yourself to be a liar and that you're not his. Fight sin. Fight pornography. Fight lust. Fight gossip. Be more like Christ. Fight greed. Fight selfishness. One of the biggest sins of all, fight pride. The arrogance that says, I got it all together. I don't need any more warnings. I just need to be taught now. As long as we're alive, we need the warnings. We need to hear them, so that we can be more like Christ. And guess what? The more like Christ you are, you will suffer. That's okay. It's proof that you're His. Jesus came and preached the most loving message ever to come out of human lips. Repent and believe. Time is at hand. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the good news, the gospel of Jesus Christ. Turn. And He suffered every day for it. Until finally, underneath God's divine, providential, predetermined hand, He was delivered over to suffer for the final, the atonement that you needed for your sins, completely and totally.
And He didn't save you and then just leave you alone. He gave you the Helper, the Holy Spirit, to comfort you, because when we suffer and we have affliction, we will need it. Or to teach us, because we need to be taught so that we can be warned. To rebuke us, because we need that. We need to, at times, feel uncomfortable so that we can find our comfort in the true source, which is God, Jesus Christ, His precious Son and the Helper He sends. And Paul doesn't want this church to miss this message. If we think about the culture they existed in, we've touched on it a little bit already. They exist in a very hedonistic culture. Many gods, many ways to God, many ways to express yourself as an individual. How different is that for us today? Not at all. We just dress differently, in different haircuts. And our shoes are probably comfortable. It's not any different today. We stand with a message of the gospel of Jesus Christ that everyone needs to hear. And it's a warning. And if you minister the gospel of Jesus Christ in its fullness, you will suffer. He's saying, Colossians, you're already experiencing this, I know this. But get ready, more is coming. And God knows that. He knows the full amount of suffering that will happen. And it's proof that you are His, because He wants to present everyone mature in Christ. If we even just think about developmentally, maturity happens as we grow, right? So we grow stronger generally. We grow in greater wisdom. We grow in greater strength to fight against sin. We grow in stature, some of us more than others. Like, I have people at my house get things off the floor for me now. It's just too far down there. But spiritually, what Paul's after here is he wants to present them as, hey, you're growing in Christ. Don't stunt your growth. Don't seek after the pleasures of this world, which can quench the Spirit and grieve the Holy Spirit. Seek for holiness. Seek to be more like Christ. Seek to be more Christ-like. And Christians, you are Christ ones. You are His. Be more like Him. Including the suffering that will surely follow. Paul's letting him know that this is all a reality for the church. This is all a reality for the church of all time, which is why this is the most timeless book ever written, because it was not anchored in a particular era. We can understand it well on the era it was written and then apply it to our lives today. And I think the best reality that we have to look forward to is that we have the hope of glory in Christ. Paul points them to that reality. To Titus, he wrote it this way in Titus 2:13. He said, looking for the blessed hope and the appearing of glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ. And then verse 14 of Titus 2, he says, who gave Himself for us to redeem us from every lawless deed and to purify for Himself a people for His own possession, zealous for good deeds. That's what He saved you for. You're being purified for Him. You are His possession. He has bought you. He has redeemed you. He laid down His life for you. And now He wants us to grow in maturity in Him, to be zealous for good deeds. To wake up in the morning and think, wow, how can I serve You today, Lord? Let that be your mindset in the morning. Be zealous for good deeds. And seek to proclaim Jesus. He is the proclamation. You are not. He was the proclamation. Paul was not. And it was Jesus he proclaims. I wanted to close our time by going back to, well, actually not back to, we haven't been there yet, but to Romans 8. And sorry, Kent and Dixie, we won't be making it to your favorite verses. Well, who knows? You never know what happens up here. We might make it. Paul's just reminded them that they have this eternal glory, this glory in Christ to look forward to, this inheritance. And in Romans 8, he builds that case with greater details, and I think details that inspire us to want to live and to mature in Christ all the more, even in the face of suffering. Romans 8, verse 12. So then, brothers, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ. Wish there was a period. Provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. Sufferings are not an anomaly to the life of Christ. Sufferings are both not to be sought nor to be avoided. Sufferings happen when you proclaim Christ. They come. God knows. That gives me hope. It helps me see that I can be comforted through suffering. God knew it would happen. I'm suffering for his name's sake. And it gives it purpose. It validates that I'm on the path that he wants for me. And that I'm going to suffer from time to time for the name of Christ. Not for being a jerk, but for the name of Christ. And that happens naturally in the life of a follower of Jesus Christ in its own way. Emotionally, physically, relationally, it happens. We don't seek it. We don't avoid it. But we seek to walk in Christ. And we do so because we're trying, underneath the power of the Holy Spirit, to put to death the deeds of the body, sin. We're doing so because we want to be led by the Spirit of God. We want that Holy Spirit who indwells us to lead us, to show us new areas of ministry, people we can pray for, or areas that we can reach into ministries that already exist in the body of Christ and maybe invest in them, Dalton Women's Center or youth group. And you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear. And you're free, brothers and sisters. You've received the spirit of adoption. And you've been adopted as sons and daughters of the God Most High. And because of that, you can cry, Abba, Father. And he hears you. You can cry, Abba, Father, when you're suffering. And he hears you. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit. How does the Spirit work? Here's an example. He bears witness with our spirit that you are children of God. What's the comfort in suffering? The reminder from the Holy Spirit that you're his. Does that mention anywhere that he alleviates the suffering? And this is the spirit that God has given you that you alleviate. No, to remind you that you're his in the suffering. It's going to happen. He will comfort you in it. And the greatest reminder is you're his. And if you are children, because you're adopted as children of God, if you are children, then you are heirs. You have an inheritance. There's no probate court that you have to go to and the government gets half of it or whatever. You don't have to fight over that with your brothers and sisters. You are heirs of God, and then blows you me away, fellow heirs with Christ. Man, you can look to Jesus as your brother, as your friend, as your co-heir of eternity. Man, that makes wings, a cloud, and a harp look pretty paltry, doesn't it? But all of this means that we will also suffer. And that we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. That your suffering has a purpose. and that Christ can walk with you through it. The Holy Spirit can comfort you through it. And then really you can see it as validation that you're His, as the Spirit reminds you of that in the midst of your suffering. I want to close with just this one quick thought, that you here in the body of Christ in Delton Community Church may be the instrument God uses to minister that comfort to others, which is another reason we come here, to minister the comfort of Christ to one another as they suffer, as we're aware of that and as we walk alongside them. So may we be more and more like Christ. May we grow in our maturity as we seek to follow Him all the more. Let's pray.